moderator for the session. Online people, please let me, please put your questions in the Hoove app and we will see that we get some time to try and answer those. And Lillian, my colleague, will be presenting today. She will also look at Hoove later on if there are any unanswered questions after this session. So if you're ready, Lillian, go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, Miriam, and welcome everyone to this session about FHIR for data delivery to quality registries. So my name is Lillian, and I have been part of the FHIRLEY team since 2017. And my role in the team is that I'm a FHIR modeling consultant. And the projects that I'm currently working on are the Dutch standard for bird care, as well as projects around data delivery to quality registries. I think most of you have heard of FHIRLEY by now, but just a little word on what we do. We have some nice tool stack, so we maintain the open source FHIRLEY.net SDK. Of course, we have the collaboration platform Simplifier, Forge profile editor tool, and our own FHIRLEY server. And if you would like to know more about it, please visit us at the booth or send us an email. So the topics that I would like to cover in this session, first I will start with a short introduction about quality registries, then tell a little bit more about the project that we do for the Dutch National Intensive Care Evaluation Registry. And finally, I will address some challenges that you can encounter doing these kind of projects. And hopefully we will have some time left for Q&A afterwards. So first, a short introduction. So the main purpose of quality registries is, of course, to monitor the quality of care and have this continuous cycle of improvement of that clinical care. And they do so by collecting the data that is entered by different care providers. And these are sent to the registry. And unfortunately, this is still being done manually most of the time by entering the data in data collection forms. And then when it gets to the registry, they will run some analysis, some statistics on the data, and they will provide back quality reports to their participants and provide them on some feedback about the quality of care that they delivered, also comparing them to other participants in the registry. And then these participants can use that feedback to take measures and improve their quality of care. And as I already mentioned, a lot of this data collection is done manually. So it is a very large burden actually for the care providers to enter all this data for all these different quality registries that exist. Because even when they collect similar data, they often use their own custom definitions. So they often have to enter the same data multiple times. And research has actually shown that care providers spend about half of their time by doing these kind of administrative tasks. So there's a need for more standardization and harmonization between these registries. So what we actually want to achieve is that we just capture the data once and then use it for multiple different purposes. And another challenge that we have is that we have higher demands on data. We want more and more data, larger volumes of data to be available. And we want it to be available quickly. So we have large demands on the performance as well. And it needs to be, for some use cases, it needs to be available even near real time or real time. So of course it's more challenging to be able to deliver this kind of requirements. So let me introduce you to the National Intensive Care Evaluation Registry. It's a Dutch registry of intensive care data. It's a very big registry. It has 82 participating ICUs, which is actually almost all, or maybe all, I'm not exactly sure, ICUs of the ICUs in the Netherlands. And their goal is to monitor and optimize the quality of the intensive care in the Netherlands. So they do that by offering audits and benchmarking. They write quality reports. They have a nice online tool. It's a self-service analysis tool that participants can use. And they also organize annual group discussions as well as team discussions where they discuss these results and discuss how they can interpret them and how they can take measures with them. And of course, this is also a very nice data set to do your scientific research on, because it's a large collection of data of all the intensive care units in the Netherlands. So just some history. I'm not going through all of it because we don't have the time for it, but it started in 1996. And it started with just a smaller minimum data set that has some collection of demographics, physiology data, diagnostics of the first 24 hours of the admission of the patient. And then it extended with some daily organ failure scores, different quality indicators, and other kind of registries. And also nice to mention is that during the COVID crisis, they also added a COVID module because they already had the infrastructure in place, so it was relatively easy to extend it with some data that was relevant for COVID. And so they were actually the main source of information for our ministry and our National Health Institute. So this is the current design that they use for data delivery. So you have here these different participants, so participating hospitals or intensive care units. And they use an extraction module that is most of the time integrated in the electronic health record system. And then they extract that data and they manually upload it to the NICE registry. So this is a nice way for the monthly and weekly data delivery. But for the daily delivery that was needed, for example, for the COVID registry, they need a different, more efficient way to deliver this data. And they are now still doing that by CSV files that are manually registered. But where they want to go, oh, that's the next lead. Just some more words about the data extraction module. So I already said it's integrated in the EPR systems. And then there are some automatic quality checks in that integrated module. But also, all of the data is validated and approved manually by a caregiver. And until it is approved, it will not be sent to the quality registry. So this is a measure that I take to be sure that all, they have a certain level of quality of the data in the registry. And then it's sent manually. But now they want to do it like this. They want to do it with FHIR. And in this image, I have the broker in place, but of course, every hospital that is participating in this can choose their own architecture to do so. But NICE will have a central fire server in place that collects all these data through fire from the different participating ICUs. So now we already started this project last year. In the first phase of the project, we started modeling the fire profiles. And we started with making a mapping for all of the data points in the registry to the Dutch national SIP models. And we translated them to the fire profiles. And then we derived our own fire profiles from the Dutch national fire profiles, which are also based on the Dutch SIPs, of course. So we are actually now at the start of the second phase, and we are still thinking about the design. But in this second phase, we will do a pilot with two hospitals, one Epic-based and one Hicks-based. And in this pilot, we will focus on the MDS registry, which is the minimal data set. And of course, we also have some plans for the future. Like we just recently started a working group to do a bit of harmonization between different registries in the Netherlands that collect intensive care data. So in the first phase, we built these fire profiles. And we actually did it in STU3. I would have preferred to do it in R4, but unfortunately, the hospitals in the Netherlands that are using fire, they are using STU3. So it doesn't make sense to now build it in R4 if the hospitals are not that far yet. And also NICTIS itself, when we started this project, NICTIS hadn't published their R4 package yet either. So we have relatively few extensions, so I was very happy about that. But we needed, for example, a couple of generic ones. For example, we want to know of every data if it's validated or not. So we did so by adding an extension, because when it is sent automatically through fire, then of course you cannot wait for that validation to be done. So you need to mark your data to be sure that it has that high level of quality that you want. We also created a larger number of value sets, and that's because NICE actually needs more specific values in their value sets than, for example, is available in the SIPs. So for example, in the SIPs, when you talk about origin, they just talk about whether a patient is coming from home or from another hospital. And in the NICE registry, we want to know more specific, is he coming from an intensive care unit or an intensive care unit from another hospital? So we have a lot of extended codes to these value sets from NICTIS. And then we also had a large part of the data that couldn't really be easily mapped to the core fire resources like patient encounter. And that applies, for example, for aggregated data, quality indicators, capacity. So we just capture them still in a questionnaire response. As I mentioned, we built a project in STU3 and we published everything on Simplifier. But I have to disappoint you that the project is still private. So I hope it will be made public. And of course, at some point they will need to, because all the participating hospitals will need to be able to explore this implementation guide. We used Simplifier implementation guide editor to make a nice dynamic implementation guide. In Simplifier, we have recently added Firely query language. And with this, you can do nice stuff in your implementation guide. For example, Because in this project, we are focusing only on the MDS registry. So we made a chapter where we will add all these different registries. And then we use a FQL query to say, if there is a mapping to the MDS registry in the profile, then it will be shown in a table that is underneath the MDS chapter. And that renders in a nice table like this, from which you can access the fire resource and have description. And they are all retrieved from the actual profile and rendered here. So yeah, this is the design that we are now thinking about. So we have a central fire server, which is multi-tenant. So each participating ICU will have their own endpoint. And then how they are going to send it to that endpoint, they can decide for themselves. So for example, we are now talking with a Dutch university hospital, and they already have a data platform in place where they also store their data according to the Dutch National Fire Profiles. And we will add either a fire broker or a fire facade server on top of that, and then send it to the central fire server. So I noticed that I don't have that much time left, so just let me quickly address some of the challenges that we encounter. First one is, of course, that you have to deal with very specific requirements for that registry, which requires, of course, custom implementations, and you always have to balance the workload for the delivering side versus the workload for the receiving side. So if you would just send raw data, then of course it would be easy for the participants, it would be more work for the quality registry, and if you do it the other way around, then would be more work for the hospitals. Yeah, I already mentioned we need more harmonization of the data points so we can actually make it more efficient for different quality registries, and of course always try to use existing standards. So another challenge that we came across, I just talked to you about sending out raw data, and we discussed that because we want to make it as easy as possible for the participating ICUs, but you are simply not allowed to receive all the raw data. There's restrictions in the data that can be sent, and it needs an actual direct purpose. So for example, one of the definitions in the data is the use of a specific medication for more than 6 months. And if the answer to that is yes, they say, okay, then you have that diagnosis. But simply sending the diagnosis, you're not allowed to do that, or sending the medication use and see for yourself if a patient is fulfilling this definition is also not allowed, because due to privacy regulations, we're not allowed to receive that. So we need to use an observation instead. And then for the hospital, it's more work because they have to do another mapping to an observation resource. Then another challenge is the anonymization of the data and the encryption of the patient identifiers. And at the site of the quality registry, we do have the key to translate it back to the original patient identifier. And we need that because if a patient has visited multiple ICUs, you want to be able to link them together. So you also need to know what is the origin from the data. So we have different ways that we can do that. And for the NICE project, we didn't decide yet. But for example, we are thinking about putting the hospital identifier in the managing organization of the patient, or maybe add something to the metadata about the source of the data, or even use the provenance resource. And the advantage of using the provenance resource is that we can also add more data to it. So for the quality check, we now use the is-validated extension. And if we use the provenance resource, we are thinking maybe we can extend it with a validation signature. And then we still need to, in that extraction model, you have a lot of automatic validations. But we didn't include all of them yet in our fire profile, so we'll need to extend them with more firepod expressions, minimum and maximum constraints, and things like that. So I went through it really fast, so I think I'm just in time. So thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, please let me know.
So officially we would be out of time, but here at least in the in-person event, we have the lunch coming up. So there is still some time for questions. And of course, if there is anyone online, please put some things in Hoova and Lillian will answer them. So I did see some raised hands already. So.
Yeah, I was wondering if you have an idea on how, it was clear how you ingest like everything in a fire, but then the analytics part, does it hook in directly on a fire server, or how is that going? Like, I can imagine for the quality measures, you have like some.
You mean when you are going to analyze the data? Are you? Yes, I'm not sure about that yet. They are not used to it to do it that way. But I think in the future it would be really nice if that would be a possibility.
Yeah.
But I think for now they will just extract their data set from it, how they are used to use it, and keep using it that way.
Are you using anything from the fire clinical reasoning stuff? Like the measures and measure reports and library and all that?
Not yet. But for now we have focused on the minimum data set, and so the actual quality indicators we are not going to collect them yet, but maybe we will use those things as well. So we really decided to focus for now on the easy part.
Okay.
And just for the pilot go with that. Yeah.
And would the data extractor replace the questionnaire? The questionnaires you're using?
The data extractor.
You mentioned the data extractor, but you're also using questionnaires right now.
No, actually, it would be the other way around, because now we have the data extraction module.
Oh, okay.
And we want it to be delivered through FHIR. And then for the data points that we couldn't fit in the in the basic resources, we decided for now we are going to use a questionnaire response, but they are not included in the FHIR project. So when we will actually really start to work with those data, we will take another look at the quality measures again and decide if this is really the way we want to go, or are we going with the quality measures. Yeah.
Thanks, Lillian, for the presentation. A question on the de-identifier of the patient data. So if the same patient comes from two different ICUs, I guess it's de-identified and sent to the registry. So is the onus on the registry now on the FHIR server to merge those, or because there's a way you said to go back to the original patient. So does it do that already? Or
yes, it does now. Now they know if they get the data from that extraction module, it's already encrypted, of course. And then they do know, okay, this data is coming from that ICU, so I need to do this and this and this, and then I get back the original patient identifier. But when we are going to send it to the FHIR server and we don't add anything about the source, then they cannot do this.
Got it. Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Oops, sorry there. Yeah, it's actually more of a follow-up to the measure report one. I was going to ask that myself, but we've actually been doing some work with the Center for Disease Control and also a little bit with CMS on moving towards this type of stuff. And we did find that even if you do send it to them in measure report with all the raw FHIR resources, that they just can't understand it. So we had to write additional, you know, basically teach their analysts how to flatten it, you know, you load it into SAS or something like that. So that I don't see that need going away even when you move to measure report, but it does get you a consistent way of delivering that then you can, load in your other tools and flatten it out and analyze. Yeah. So
thank you. Well,
oh yeah, Diego, sure.
We can also
last question then.
Yeah, we can also take
you,
it.
You stated that you have different tenants for each hospital.
Yes.
But is that tenancy enforced? Because if you want to see all the measures, you need to see every tenant information from some place. If you if you want to know all the measures, you need to get the information from all the tenants. So they are the tenants, but you are the actual owner. The registry is the actual owner of all the information. Or you?
Yes, the registry is the owner of all.
So it's not tenant.
Okay, yeah. But what I meant
no, because
is that,
I have the same problem
what
with one of
what
the projects.
What I meant is that every participating ICU has their own endpoint where they will send their data.
But the registry can access everything.
Yes, of course, because it is pushed to the central fire server, and the central fire server, the registry is the owner of that central fire server.
Yeah,
so
it's,
they
a, very,
can
it's a very technical definition
access.
Because
okay.
they have I'm in a project where they are adding a tenant to the endpoint. So it's, for instance, if the tenant is A, then the endpoint is endpoint slash A slash patient.
Okay.
Understand? And then if you want all the patients, you should put the A first to get to the patient.
Yes, that's true.
So that's my question going to.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Lillian, for this
thank
presentation.
You.
And well, have a good lunch.